Hi folks, welcome to Radio Farside. I'm standing here about 6 degrees south of the equator, which is roughly 1,000 kilometers that way. As you can see, beautiful tropical climate. I've got sugarcane, olives, mangoes, figs, and my prized possession, Texas pink grapefruit, growing back over here. So I've got everything up here. Beautiful climate, beautiful soil. I moved here because I thought, hey, this would be year-round growing season and always warm and temperate. Little did I know that I may be standing at the new North Pole. Sound impossible? Stay tuned. Well, howdy, friends and neighbors. Welcome back to Radio Farside. I'm your host, Bernard Grover, and today we're going to go about as far as we can because there's nothing bigger than the universe. Before we get too far afield, please take a moment to like, subscribe, share, comment, and don't forget to rinse and repeat because that doubles the amount of product you use and you'll have to come back for more. In this installment of Radio Farside, we're talking about life, the universe, and everything. And believe me, it doesn't get much bigger than that. The state of physics and astrophysics today is that things are in flux and they're changing very quickly. And one of the people who has emerged at the forefront of this new physics is a man named Ben Davidson. Ben Davidson created spaceweathernews.com and the Mobile Observatory Project. His textbook on the Sun and the Earth is now being used in 35 universities. He leads a citizen science collective of more than 450,000 people and is on the frontier of the science on space weather, astrophysics, and the ongoing pole shift at Earth. This is going to be a fascinating discussion. Do stick around, and without further ado, let's meet Ben. Welcome to Radio Farside, Ben. It's a real pleasure to have you join us.
It is a pleasure to be here. Thank you.
Thank you very much. It's something that I've really been wanting to discuss, especially with my Indonesian audience. There are certain things that have a lot of implications for this audience here. Which we'll get into shortly. But to begin with, I kind of wanted to define a few terms so that when they come up in the conversation, everybody is on the same page. And if you could give us a brief definition of what is cosmology as opposed to, say, astronomy.
Sure. Astronomy would be the large umbrella field of everything looking at space, but cosmology would be specifically the study of how the universe began, how it evolved to where it is now, and what is the current large-scale structure of the universe. So right now, most scientists go with the idea that the universe began with the Big Bang and that it has been basically expanding outwards from there for about 14.7, 14.8 billion years, something like that, maybe less, you know. And basically that would be what has resulted in what they call the cosmic web. Basically all the galaxies in the universe or most of them are connected in this sort of stringy-like web throughout the universe, or, you know, so they think. And so that would be the difference. Cosmology would be a smaller subset of astronomy, again, looking at how did the universe begin and how did it get to where it is now and what exactly is it now at the largest scales that we can barely even begin to wrap our heads around.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, when you start dealing with some of these numbers, even to the nearest star, it's mind-boggling. Is it fair to say that the Big Bang cosmology is deficient because it doesn't really contemplate how life fits into that That's something that's always seemed to have struck me about that whole concept.
Well, I think there's a lot of reasons to be suspicious of what is currently the most popular paradigm. I can say that I haven't thought as much about the appearance of life. What I can say is that in my studies of astronomy at the great scale, and that includes astrophysics, galactic physics and cosmology, is I see things in the heavens that really tell me that this is not some accidental, random, chaotic soup that has just formed things randomly over time. There's too much pattern at different scales, from the largest ones we can imagine down to the smallest ones we can probe with, electron microscopes and pulses of lasers trying to figure out where electrons are around atoms and other things like that. It kind of forces you to be a believer if you can take that broadest scale approach, because it looks more like pattern and design than it does anything else. Even if we don't have a signature anywhere, I guess in this case it would be God's signature. It's not signed on anything. It's almost like we're going to give you just enough to let your human brains know that there's something going on here. And then I'm going to give you nothing else.
Yeah, it's an interesting conundrum and a challenge, really. I kind of see a signature in the repetition of certain forms from the micro to the macro. I see the helix and Birkeland currents. I see Birkeland currents in DNA, and I see the toroid structure and spirals. They seem to repeat at every scale, and it seems, in order to have that kind of broad scope of rules that apply at every scale, there has to be some kind of structure, that some kind of set of rules, and that implies somebody making the rules.
Yeah, that's not a bad way to look at it, for sure.
Now, a couple of more definitions. What is plasma cosmology?
Sure. So plasma cosmology, or as some people call it, plasma universe, basically suggests that there is not a dark matter, first of all. And it's really just dust and plasma, which is protons, electrons, charged ions, other things like that, the conductive ionized gases in space that we just don't see very well yet. Every time we stack more Hubble images on top of one another, or we get a new telescope that looks in a different way, we discover more dust, more plasma out there where the dark matter is supposed to be. And so it's not only out there doing the gravitation, but it's got its electromagnetic forces as it's moving and flowing and co-rotating. So, and this is one of the basic tenets. And you push that forward and backward. Forward in time, it tells us a lot about how we're interacting with the sun, and how the sun actually plays a role in weather, in earthquakes, in volcanoes, in human health, in the performance of our electrical technology. Going back in time, it really changes the timeline of the universe. It implies that maybe it doesn't have one. It also strongly conflicts with the Big Bang. Now, the Big Bang theory and the science that has spawned from it is doing a fantastic job conflicting with itself these days, whether it's finding supermassive quasars or galaxies or proto-galaxies way too early in the universe to have happened, when they think it happened after the Big Bang. There's just no way, not enough time had passed for these things to have come together. Or the fact that they are finding all of that plasma and dust where they didn't think it was going to be. The Hubble constant and a number of other constants in the universe are under serious duress, if I can put it that way. Every time they look at it with a new device or a new satellite or telescope, they seem to come up with a different answer. And so these pa you know, this larger paradigm of the cold dark matter cosmology, which is what we have now, is basically getting Swiss cheesed by the modern research, if I can put it that way. Just every time I look, there's a new hole that's been poked in it.
Yeah, and that's something that I've really appreciated about your YouTube channel, which is an amazing resource. You've got, I don't know how many hundreds of videos up there spanning almost a decade now, with some brilliant information. One of the best free resources I've found on the internet of any topic. So I do highly recommend that people get over to Suspicious Observers on YouTube. And that's where I've gotten this concept that the Big Bang universe is truly a dying paradigm because it can't support the theories or the ideas that have been hung on it.
That's pretty accurate. I was just saying, no, that's pretty accurate. It's not being supported by modern observations. It would also predict that, you know, the expansion rate of the universe is equal in all directions, and that was strongly questioned this year. Mm. You know, they still can't find dark matter anywhere they look. They discovered that the electromagnetic force is not equal in all directions, implying that we're sort of inside of some kind of a dipole. There have been implications to that effect, whether it's a torus jet feature or a sphere magnet. They keep finding these tweaks to the universe that make them question, or should make them question more than is questioned, their standard paradigm.
Especially when you start listening to people like Stephen Carruthers, who rips apart black holes and general relativity. You've got Anthony Peratt, who's done brilliant work relating ancient petroglyphs with modern plasma physics. Gosh, what else? You've got Pierre Robitaille, who's in the process of just ending the cosmic microwave background.
He's literally sending it down the plank.
Yes, he's making it walk. Exactly. Yeah, and he's brilliant. I have to watch his videos 4 or 5 times to get everything that's in there, because he's such a brilliant guy. But all these people are so easily shooting apart what I grew up thinking was sacrosanct science. And right. Where are we going from here? You mentioned the universe possibly being a sphere magnet, a dipole. What does that mean?
Well, it's hard to say what that means. And maybe it means we're inside one of those shapes. But the place where we're going to get some real evidence next is with the next level technologies. You know, we can stack Hubble images until we're blue in the face. It's only going to give us so much. If the James Webb telescope ever manages to fly, it will give us some good information. But in reality, we have one of the most unfathomable ironies that's going to play out. So the low surface brightness telescopes that are about to go online, the flagship one of them being at the Vera Rubin Observatory, are going to reveal so much of this missing dust and plasma that they're going to have to say, wait a minute, can't have any more dark matter. And the funny thing is that Vera Rubin is the woman who crushed plasma cosmology in favor of dark matter. She's the reason why we have a dark matter cosmology today, as opposed to plasma cosmology. Her and Anthony Peratt were at a number of meetings together a few decades ago, and this was back when Anthony Peratt was the student of Hannes Alfvén, and apparently that it really happened in a just a few years when that theory really became solidified. And it is going to be her namesake observatory that delivers the evidence that, in my opinion, will crush her theory forever.
Well, you've got to love the delicious irony in that one.
Yes.
When we talk about all this magnetism in the universe, and we let's say we assume, because things are falling apart so quickly, we assume that electricity and magnetism are both hands of the same body. Does that imply that the electric universe is a real thing? I know a lot of people tend to equate plasma cosmology and the electric universe as if they are one and the same. Is that an accurate description?
Well, it should have been one and the same. It really shouldn't matter if you call it plasma, electric, or magnetic. Unfortunately, today, the term electric universe has been sort of gobbled up, twisted a little bit, and copyrighted by a group that is seeking to promote a decades-old agenda because, you know, some of the survivors of that agenda have lots of money, and that's where they get their funding. Mm. And so, unfortunately, where we stand today, the electric universe crowd is not what it is supposed to be, even though it's taken and built its foundation on all of the correct plasma cosmology science. The tangents and offshoots are a little bit more bent than they should be, and their linking to the plasma cosmology trunk of the tree manages to get obscured more than it should as well. And so we've kind of come to the point where magnetic universe, plasma cosmology, there's a number of people, and it's a shame that it's come to this, but it's at least easy to figure out. The people using those terms are the ones who are carrying forward what Christian Birkeland did and what Hannes Alfvén did and what Anthony Peratt is still doing. And then there's the separate electric universe stuff, which is, you know, hopefully one day it'll come back around. But for right now, unfortunately, it's gone off the rails.
Hmm. Interesting. Yeah, I know, because when you mention electric universe, a lot of people start rolling their eyes. But plasma cosmology still seems to perk up ears, and it seems to be gaining steam.
Right. It is due to the correct predictions that it's been shown to have, in addition to the deficiencies with the current model that are being revealed with all these studies. You put those two things together, and you know, the second one I mentioned, all of these problems, they force the question, oh, well, why can't we get this stuff right? Or is there anybody that did get this stuff right? Hmm. And then that comes to the other part. Well, oh, yes, there is a cosmology that does predict these things and does have explanations for these new things that we see. And it's a slow process, but it is going towards the plasma in that regard.
Well, I think what's really exciting about this particular period in cosmology is that for a long time there was a sense, especially with students, that thought, well, why pursue that, because everything's been discovered that can be discovered. And now it looks as if there's a lot of room for new discoveries, for people to make a name for themselves. And one thing I would hope that potential students in this area would get from listening to you is that there's really, literally, an entire universe out there still waiting to be discovered.
Yeah, they don't fully understand how the universe began or if it began. They don't fully understand how it evolved to be what it is now. They don't really understand what it is now. They definitely don't understand how galaxies spin. They don't understand how stars work. They don't understand how the sun works. That stuff I mentioned about how the sun interacts with Earth and affects our health, technology, weather, earthquakes. They're starting to understand that, but at a very infant or toddler level, and there's a long, long way to go. They are still looking for this tiny magical particle, dark matter. They don't know what's going on at the tiniest levels of physics either. Mm. You know, we are at the point now where the botanists and ecologists who have been screaming that Earth plants have been starved of CO2 for 4 million years, they've given up and they've stopped trying. And there's so much, literally almost everything we know outside of the basic things like arithmetic, 2 + 2 = 4. I'm not saying stuff like that, but when we try to model these things that are so complex and have a million different factors, we project too much of our assumptions and our beliefs into these models, which are just human created anyway. Even the best artificial intelligence is as biased as you could ever imagine. And in fact, because it's got the bias in there and because it's a powerful machine, that error propagates at large scale, kind of like the butterfly flaps his wings in Peking, and in Central Park you get rain instead of sunshine, if I may quote Jeff Goldblum mm-hmm. from Jurassic Park. That's called error propagation at scale. As the twig is bent, so grows the tree. The more you bend the twig as it's growing, the more bent the tree will get. And that's called error propagation at larger scale. Something broken in the foundation can literally collapse a 100-story tall structure, even if nothing else is wrong with the structure itself. No, just that's the basic idea, and that's why there is an entire universe, big to small, that is open and available.
Well, I think one example that proves your point is something as basic as gravity. Nobody really knows what it is.
No, they really don't. And, you know, even plasma cosmology's general idea, it's more of a qualitative description. The reason why mass and matter have this force, and even the way that it's tried to explain, it's like, okay, well, if you're going to explain it with this, why does it do that then? You know, it's almost like you keep coming up with this, oh, well, this happens because this happens. Well, why does that happen? And why does that happen? And why does that? There's an entire world of possibilities and questions to ask. And we have not discovered 1% of what there is to discover.
And as a student, I would think that that's extremely exciting. I think the big issue, though, is the entrenchment in academia, partly due to politics and partly due to money, that is unwilling to budge on any of these topics or is grudgingly shifting their position. But how do we change that? It seems intractable at this point.
You know, it's difficult to say exactly how it will happen, but what I can say is the universe is a snitch. Hmm. The universe loves telling on people. The universe loves to give hints right at the most inconvenient time for the largest amount of people doing the least righteous things. And I've got some faith in Earth, in the sun, and in the universe in general, that they've got stuff up their sleeves and they're just waiting for the right time.
Oh, that's a very interesting viewpoint. I like that.
Well, I mean, yeah, I can go outside right now and see like 100 little green, you know, starts of tomatoes coming on this plant. I can see them and I know exactly what they're going to be. It does me no good to go pick those things right now, you know? Yeah. I need to wait until they get bigger and they get red and other things like that. There is a time for everything. And there's one thing I have learned in how we'll mention something even just casually. And then all of a sudden it seems like there's a flood of information about it for weeks that allows us to go on this unbelievable rabbit hole digging experience and basically change the way we think about a specific topic forever. This has happened so many times. It's more than just serendipity or providence. Things are unfolding in a very, 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 very wonderful way. And I'm just going to continue to let it do so and have faith that it's going to continue to do so in this way. It's doing so on this front and in that way as amazingly as some things in this world are going the opposite direction and giving people legitimate reasons to have fear and anxiety and other things that you would call negative emotions and things like that. It's all happening at the same time and probably not coincidentally either.
And I'm glad you brought that up because that segues us into the next topic I want to bring up. It's kind of interesting with all the negativity on the planet at this time. I don't know if you're familiar with a guy named Cliff High.
Yes.
He calls it space goat farts. That these energies from outer space are increasing on the planet and causing mental and physical upset in the human creature. What do you think of that?
Yeah, so you're reminding me of the first time Cliff High ever did something on my work back in 2012. It was shocking because I had been a fan of his for 2 years, and then all of a sudden there I was, you know, being talked about by Cliff. Cliff's got some good insight here, and this is one of the things that we've been talking about for quite some time. Earth's magnetic field. We have a magnetic shell around the planet called the magnetosphere. It's fading. More space energy is getting in. The planet is juicing up very much so. And this absolutely has an effect on our brains, on our blood pressure, on hormone release, neural connections, things in our locus coeruleus that react to anxiety and fear and panic, things in our hippocampus that degrade cognitive ability, that increase emotional instability. All of those things are going up. In fact, I just reported yesterday, we are at the cosmic ray maximum for modern times. It's probably been 400 years since cosmic rays have been this high.
And interestingly, that's about the last time we had a huge global upset. There seems to be a pattern in human history where humanity reaches a nexus and has to make a choice on which way to go, and this seems to be one of those times.
Well, you know, it's interesting because this is like the most horrendous cosmic coincidence I could ever imagine, because there is that cycle at the global scale, but there's also another cycle that's linking up right now about every 78 to 85 years, which is also the Uranus orbital cycle. There's a major upset on the planet. The economic collapse in Europe and the start of America back in the 1760s into 1770s.
That's right.
Was one of them. The next time it happened, it was the Civil War in this country. The time after that, it was the Great Depression leading into World War II. And Uranus just entered Taurus last year. Here we go again. Civil unrest, economic uncertainty, and the war hasn't happened yet, but that's always how it ends. That's what's coming here. And unfortunately, we've got other cosmic cycles linking up to it, and we have other challenges. What's happening with Earth's magnetic field is a 12,000-year cycle, and that one happens to be linking up at the exact same thing, too. It's like different clock cycles all linking up in a computer together. And this is going to be a challenge beyond challenges, what we've got ahead of us here.
Interestingly, that's kind of how I drew a connection with Indonesia, is the magnetic poles seem to be making a beeline straight for us. And according to, what was it, Chen Thomas?
Of course, Chen Thomas and other people. And I have to say, you know, when I saw Chen Thomas's idea of where it was going to be, my jaw dropped, because I had been promoting that as the next pole position potentially for about 3.5 years already. It's something that I still struggle to get my head around, but that's only before I remember that the things that are causing me to struggle are all these things that are part of a paradigm I see crumbling all around me, and I don't know why I cling to them. And once you let go of this notion that Earth is just this unstoppable inertial machine that will not change tilt, will not change rotation, will not flip over. You know, Einstein died, like many great geophysicists before him, trying to figure out what mechanism caused the Earth to flip over, not questioning whether or not it happened, trying to figure out how it happened. He died not knowing that, and unfortunately, he never looked outside the Earth for something to give Earth enough power to do something like that. He never looked at the sun or the galaxy or anything like that. And neither did any of the people that came before him, understandably. You know, this is, once you get past that and you realize that if maybe it were not for a couple CIA/NSF funded studies, if not for their classification of Chan Thomas's work, and if not for their agents parading around as professors, specifically Charles Hapgood, putting out fake versions of crustal displacement that were so easy to debunk that they basically just tanked the entire field of science, everyone would know this, would remember what the ancients knew. And unfortunately, both poles are set to converge somewhere, you know, somewhere in between the northern parts of Indonesia, you know, up at the northwest, and where it bends back around to the east towards Oceania. Mm-hmm. The poles are set to meet somewhere right there, Bay of Bengal area. We have seen so much strange geologic action, and I'm not just talking about the big earthquakes that have happened there. Strange sea floor changes that don't really make sense unless right. something is happening beneath there. Buoys being shut down, data disappearing, and it just, you know, to this day, never coming back. There's just too much there, and it just so happens that the opposite place in the world, you know, if you were to say, okay, well, that's one pole, where's the other part, where's the other pole? It's right where Ecuador and Peru is, and where some other very, very interesting islands are just off the coast there in the far central eastern Pacific. Yeah, so there's just an absolutely unbelievable set of coincidences to these things as well. Not to mention the fact that the largest magnetic anomaly in the field right now is called the South Atlantic Anomaly, and it overlaps where the other pole would be. Interestingly, you know, most people have heard of the Bermuda Triangle. I don't know if that's true over in your part of the world, but the Bermuda Triangle is basically just a stride of where the other new pole would be. And it's got a corollary called the Dragon's Triangle over in, over close to where you are.
Right.
And that's just a stride of where we think that the pole is going to be there. There's just literally every coincidence, every which way where you want to say, all right, well, why don't we look at this instead and see if maybe we can find a way to doubt it? We've literally done this with every electromagnetic aspect of the planet, of the weather, even anomalous / conspiracy things like the Bermuda and Dragon's Triangle. We can't get away from it pointing to Indonesia and Peru / Ecuador
right.
as being North and South Pole.
That's fascinating. As if, you know, there's obvious indicators on the planet at this time telling us, you know, this is what's going to happen. I guess the thing that is most concerning is it's not just the magnetic pole reversal that what you've been talking about in some of your videos is that the Earth, the crust, comes loose from the mantle and right. actually starts going wonkers.
Yeah, and so that's the interesting thing. I think that you get yanked towards one pole and the other place gets yanked. Whether or not you end up staying there is another question. You know, the only reason that the plates don't bang around and that we are able to stay at the same latitude for, you know, hundreds, thousands of years is because there's this plastic high friction layer in between the crust and the liquid mantle. And it's called the low velocity zone. And it takes a delicate thermoelectric equilibrium to create this. And both thermally and electrically, this thing is going to be disrupted. It is going to be disequilibriumed, if I can make up a word right there. and when that happens, there will be nothing that stops Greenland from trying to tug its part of the plate towards the equator. There'll be nothing that stops the Mid-Atlantic Ridge and its outward push from, you know, doing things at the Caribbean and probably triggering the East African Rift on the other side of Africa. The fault line that basically just runs along the equator and includes the southern part of your country. I swear I have nightmares about it.
Yeah.
Especially in that scenario. So it's really difficult to think about things like this. But it's unfortunately where a lot of this is heading.
Wow. It's a sobering thought because actually when I moved here, I went through my very first earthquake. I've been through I don't know how many hurricanes and tornadoes and everything. But an earthquake is an entirely different experience.
Right.
When literally the world under your feet starts moving. To think of it on a scale so huge that, you'd have to redraw the maps is mind-boggling. It just, I can't even conceive of it.
Yes, I would say so. The biggest thing really is going to be the fact that the tsunamis are going to be unfathomable. And given the fact that there will be a number of volcanoes and landslides in your part of the world, that's something else to think about. But in this event where literally the ocean is getting sloshed around by a moving crust beneath it, it's not like the Hollywood 2 mile high tidal wave that you could, you know, you can envision someone surfing it in a, if they were crazy enough. Mm-hmm. It's more like a fast moving high tide, a high tide that just doesn't stop, you know, and just is going 10 times faster than normal. The kind of thing where if you stood there when it touched your feet, 5 or 6 minutes later, the water would be as high as your head. Mm. And it's not going to stop for hours. And it's going to literally cover mountains and other things like that before going back down. All you need is a floatable. Literally, you see the water rising, just go stand in your floatable thing and float away, you know? Take some time to put some food and some other things in there you think you might need, and then just float away. Now, there is, of course, the other aspect of this where, you know, there's a luck aspect to this, and there's almost no question that some kind of major solar blast is involved. And we're not talking about a regular solar flare in coronal mass ejection. We're talking about something where the entire top part of the corona just blasts off in a micronova. The X-ray flash from that and the increased UV will probably cook the 25 to 30% most sun-facing part of the Earth. And then when that shell arrives, it will have impactors in it, unfortunately. So the last time this happened, and here would be the good news for Indonesia. The last time this happened, I actually think a good portion of your part of the world got cooked. It doesn't happen twice in a row. The shell hit the Americas last time. That's why that place was basically abandoned from, you know, more advanced life. There was basically the Native Americans who had just, in terms of geologic history, recently crossed the bridge from Alaska and were still spreading across North America. Uh-huh. That's the reason why it was so bare there. And that's why the most surge deposits are in Alaska and other things like that, because that's where the shell hit. I put a lot of faith in the concept that, quote, the world will not be destroyed by water, but by fire. Except if the further you look back in the versions of that text, it's not the entire world. It's their world. It's the world that God chose for them. It's just their chosen land that isn't taking flood next time. It's taking the fire. And going, you know, just based on how it's ticking around the world, it looks like it's the Middle East, parts of Europe and Africa that are going to take the flash next time, not Indonesia. And it looks like the shell will probably hit the Central Pacific. That doesn't put you completely out of the water, pun not intended, but hilariously on point. But it does mean that there's probably some parts of India, China, and Indonesia, and other areas around there that may not take the absolute worst of this. Now, the flooding, the weather, everything else like that is going to be as terrible as we could have imagined. And in truth, you know, some impactors may be a few hours early. Some impactors may be a few hours late.
Yeah.
Throughout the duration, from flash to impact, there is a cosmic ray bombardment causing – now, this isn't the kind of thing that burns, but it can cause DNA mutations, other things like that. It can really help to cloud out the sky and cause very bad storms. Cosmic rays can help juice up lightning and affect how much precipitation is falling in a storm.
And we can kind of get a taste of that now. I know that China right now is underwater. You just mentioned this morning that India had one of the most incredible bolts of lightning I've ever heard of, with 100 people killed. There's so much weird weather going on now.
Well, you know, that was the third lightning thing I've reported just this week.
Right.
There was one that was caught on camera earlier this week that you could sit there and count it out. One, two. It was 5 or 6 seconds longer than the official world record when that day began. But just coincidentally, while that lightning was being recorded, the American Geophysical Union was releasing that the record had been broken, and the record breaker was like 10 seconds longer than the one that had gotten filmed. It was like 16 seconds long. It was unbelievable. There was another one that apparently traveled 200 miles. A lightning bolt of 200 miles is unheard of. That's basically a thunderbolt from the gods.
And that goes back to, you know, some of these ancient symbols that
right.
A number of researchers have done a lot of amazing work on. But the idea of Zeus's thunderbolts, if you imagine a 200-mile-long thunderbolt, you know, it's a lot easier to imagine people seeing something many times that, and certainly coming up with thunderbolts of the gods as an explanation.
Yeah, well, essentially what's happening is, you know, there's constantly an atmospheric electric circuit. Whether or not people realize that there's electricity flowing through the atmosphere, there's an electric gradient as you go up. The higher up you go, yeah, there's less and less air, but there's more and more electricity. And in sunny days when there's not many clouds and there's high pressure, there's actually electricity that flows downward from the top of the sky down to the ground and depositing in different layers of the atmosphere, atmospheric boundary layers, on what clouds are there, what water vapor or dust is in the air, helping to form the clouds that will have big lightning strikes that help stir up the energy to shoot back up to the sky in low pressure and, you know, in thunderstorms. What's happening as we're losing our magnetic field is this shift is becoming stronger. We're taking in more charge and we have to discharge more as well. Whenever, you know, whenever you see a video where it looks like lightning is crawling across the sky, and then when it hits the ground, it's almost like it flashes in one place for like two or three or four repetitions, almost in the same place. What's happening there is the static discharge is finding that accumulated charge in the ground. And when the lightning bolt actually hits the ground from the clouds, it creates a path of least resistance back out for that accumulated charge, that capacitance there.
Yeah.
And that's what we're seeing with these super lightning strikes. The Earth's taking in too much energy, and therefore it's releasing too much energy in these lightning strikes.
The greater the electric field around the Earth, then obviously the lightning will have a commensurate scale as well, I assume.
Well, absolutely. And these cosmic rays aren't helping. Like I said, they do two things. They deposit charge. I mean, they are charged particles. And when they come in through the atmosphere, they deposit themselves. When they hit other particles, they knock electrons off. They knock protons off. They create gamma rays and X-rays. Not to mention, they leave the particles that they hit. They're missing an electron or missing a proton, so they're charged up now as well. And unfortunately, this has another problematic implication for your part of the world, because the highest energy cosmic rays, the very highest energy among them, can go right through the Earth without hitting anything. But just a step below that, those ones hit the mantle. And they seem to have the most effect on the silica-rich magma viscosity within potentially explosive volcanoes.
That's very comforting, considering I'm positioned right now directly between the ocean and a volcano.
Yeah, there is the expectation that the volcanic activity is probably going to rise as the cosmic rays continue to rise. And it's probably on a 3 to 6 year lag in terms of spikes of increase and spikes in volcanic activity, which is kind of putting us due here actually in the next year or so to start another volcanic uptick on the planet.
Well, because the cosmic rays have been increasing for some time now. So what you're saying is that the effect of that will come back to haunt us in the near future.
Well, you know, they have been for some time, but at the same time, the 11-year sunspot cycle strongly modulates it. Mm. And so for the period of 2012, 2014, 2017, even though we are losing Earth's magnetic field more and more, when the sun was active during that time, we weren't getting as many cosmic rays because the sun's solar flares and CMEs tend to block them out during the sunspot maximum phase of the cycle. But now that we have been in the sunspot minimum for a few years, we can see that the cosmic ray levels are even higher than they were, you know, higher than they've been basically on record. And we can only infer that the last time the sun went to sleep must have been the last time the cosmic rays were this high. This is the highest we have on the official measured record, you know, not talking about going in and pulling isotopes out of an ice core, but I'm talking about measured with modern technological instruments. We've never seen levels this high.
Wow. All these cycles. And in fact, talking about this, I want to go back a minute because you mentioned micronovas. And to those of us who hobbyists in this field, we think of novas and supernovas as the dying breath of a star. And after that, it's one big boom and it's all over. But what you're saying with these micronovas is that, and there's apparently a lot of evidence being gathered about this, that stars can go boom a lot.
Right. So they have a class of what they call rapidly recurring nova, and those have anything from a 1 to less than 100 year recurrence rate. They know about 10 or 11 of those right now. But they believe that all classical nova, all the ones where there's still a star left in the middle, are actually recurring, and their cycles last from thousands to millions of years. In terms of not destroying the star, there's something called a dwarf nova, which apparently happens just outside the star in its dusty disk. The nova aspect of a type 1 X-ray burst from a pulsar, yeah, there is a all-direction shell release from that one, but if it happened at the sun, the shell wouldn't even reach Mercury before dissipating into nothing. Mm. And so what I'm talking about isn't even the smallest of all kinds of nova. The sun isn't on the longest of cycles, the millions of years one. I believe the sun's probably on this, on the magnetic excursion cycle of Earth, about 12,000 years. And the micronova is the only way to actually account for all of the evidence that you have to account for, not just some, not just, oh, it really explains this part, but it struggles with this other one. No, in terms of explaining all of the evidence you have to explain about the recurrent catastrophe of Earth, mm-hmm. the micronova is the only way to do it. It's the only way to explain why ancient people blame the sun for so many of these things and say that the sun basically can become the destroyer. It's the only thing that would make sense in terms of something that could happen at that power level astronomically. And we actually know that there's a perfectly good physical explanation for how that would happen as a sun is orbiting in the Milky Way galaxy. Maybe that's not a terrible place to start. And so it's not like a galactic wave, and it's not that crossing the galactic equator thing that you may have heard. But there's an electric field that ripples north and south in a sine wave, north and south of the galactic equator. Okay. And when Earth crosses that, and the math says it should probably be about every 10 to 15,000 years that this thing crosses our path, it's going to do two things. One, just like a Swiffer duster in your home, this electric field is carrying an enormous amount of dust with it, and this is going to get deposited into the solar system, but most importantly into the upper atmosphere of the sun. Then the electromagnetic component of this, which separates the north and south magnetic fields of the galaxy, ergo, this is a galactic magnetic reversal event that the sun is about to go through. Hmm. It will briefly throw a kink into the engine of outpouring solar wind, and that will cause a further accumulation in the corona. Of course, this doesn't last forever, and there's a whole bunch of ultraviolet light and solar wind that's then trying to get out, but the vent is blocked. Oh. And it's locked up at the top. And when the sun has built up enough energy in there and it's no longer being glitched out by the magnetism and it's trying to blast full force, It's the difference between holding a firecracker in the palm of your hand and closing your fist around that firecracker. If I can use the line from Armageddon, you know, the first one just burns your hand. The second one blows your fingers off. And that's what's going to happen. It's basically at the same time a double whammy, an accumulation and a glitch out. Causing, I mean, here's the interesting thing. They say that this is actually, these are two of the ways that a nova can actually happen. Yes, when a star runs out of fuel in the middle, they say it goes boom. And yes, that supernova means the star is over. But in terms of the ones that happen over and over again, they say that there's two things that can cause it. One, too much material accumulates in the atmosphere or the corona of the star. And number two, there's some kind of electromagnetic glitch that causes a plasma instability. This can either directly cause an ejection of the corona or glitch out the solar wind, which causes an accumulation. And then we're back to the first mechanism. Both of those things come with this galactic sheet. And most of the science on the galactic magnetic field says that this thing, which is called a Parker spiral instability or a Parker instability of a plasma field. It exists around the sun. It exists around the Earth, around Jupiter. We can create them in a lab, and it's how the galaxy works too. And even though, for example, it takes Earth a year to go around the sun, The sun's rippling current sheet hits us every 2 weeks. It takes us millions of years to go around the galaxy, but only about 10 to 15,000 years for that galactic sheet to whip past us. And so we have a double whammy nova trigger. And so you have to say to yourself, okay, well, if this is related to what's happening right now, all right, Mr. Smarty Pants, why don't you take a look at the stars that are in a line between us and the center of the galaxy? And in terms of our technology, we could really only gauge about the two or three, you know, stars in line ahead of us. Mm-hmm. And they've all been going nuts. One of them, Proxima Centauri, released its record flare a couple of years ago. And after that, a star that was thought not to be a flare star after being observed for decades, all of a sudden started unleashing flares. Now, these are red dwarf stars, and so we don't expect them to have the nova. We expect them to have an increase in flaring. Okay. So it's literally they're happening in a line, and the sun is next. And so you might say, well, all right, Mr. Smarty Pants, why don't we see evidence of this on the other planets? Do we see magnetic changes and weather changes on the other planets? Well, yes, we certainly do. Turns out that you need an atmosphere on the planet to really notice it. But at Venus, the fastest winds are getting faster. In fact, 33% faster. And there's evidence that its rotation speed is changing. At Mars, it was global warming faster than we were for most of the 20th century. They're having earthquakes they can't explain, and its magnetic field is having interesting fluctuations.
Yeah, I saw that.
At Jupiter, there are interesting radio emissions. The Great Red Spot was having trouble. One of the color bands disappeared. And by the way, the strange radio emissions are caused by electrons caught in Jupiter's magnetic field. At Saturn, its every 30-year superstorm came a decade early. It's having weird auroral activity and weird storms as well. And there was some uncertainty about its rotation, about whether or not it was changing. We've seen record storms and record auroras on both Uranus and Neptune as well. Now, the interesting thing is I mentioned wind at Venus. I mentioned earthquakes at Mars. I mentioned electrons caught in the magnetic field at Jupiter, auroras, record storms. All of these things are affected by if a magnetic field of a planet starts to change. I think Jupiter's the only one that's obvious. Literally, the radio emission coming from its magnetic field is changing. But with the other ones, we can see it in the weather. We can see it in the auroras and at Pluto. They just reported that Pluto has lost 20% of its atmosphere in no more than 3 years. It's having an atmospheric collapse, which must be caused by a magnetic field collapse at the planet. And guess which planet is out in the direction most of the center of the galaxy of where that wave would be coming from? Pluto.
Pluto. Now, to put that in perspective, though, there's long been a theory that Pluto, when it goes out to its furthest point from the sun, its atmosphere automatically freezes out. But what you're saying is that it's doing so much faster than anybody expected.
Well, so essentially, that was supposed to begin to happen in 1989 after it hit its closest point to the sun. Mm. Ever since 1989, it's been moving slightly further away from the sun, and yet its atmosphere has been slowly increasing in pressure and increasing in pressure. The last time they were able to look was 2016, and then they looked again last year, and they saw 20% of it had just disappeared.
Wow.
This is not what they are talking about at all. They're talking about a slow freeze out where literally, you know, in 1989, it was at its closest point. In more than 100 years, it'll be at its furthest point away. They don't expect a 20% difference throughout that entire time. Wow. Yes, they did expect a bunch of it to cool and turn to ices and fall to the ground. But they didn't expect it to lose this much, and certainly not this fast. It's had a collapse event. And I think that the wave might actually be there. Now, interestingly, Neptune would probably be next, but Uranus is actually trying to sneak its way around to the other side of the solar system, and Saturn would be up after that, with Jupiter not long behind it. But so it's amazing. We actually have this physical explanation at the galactic level, not just in terms of triggering the nova two different ways, but on the same kind of timeline that we can recognize here on Earth. I mean, when Earth crosses this every 2 weeks, because there's not as much dust in the solar system, we don't get that much of the dust component. It's not like the dust in the galaxy. That's a serious thing.
Right.
But it still manages to cause a global electromagnetic disruption on the planet Earth. That's not what you want to see happen on your star from the galaxy. It's a bad day. And yes, we already see it starting to happen at the stars. You'd expect to see it happening too, right before it started happening to the sun. Yes, you see the planets starting to react already as though it's already begun to happen. And yes, we know that because we can monitor Earth's magnetic field, that it is changing in those crazy ways, in ways it hasn't changed in about 12,000 years since the Gothenburg magnetic excursion and the terrible things that happened there.
Mm.
I will quickly mention that before that, we had Mono Lake about 12, 13,000 years before that, Lake Mungo magnetic excursion, Lachamp. These things are coming every 10 to 15,000 years, and the field doesn't react like this unless it's going into this excursion mode. And so the timing is perfect, whether you're looking at the evidence we can observe from the galaxy, the physical theory in terms of what we're observing from the galaxy, in terms of what we're observing on Earth and the cycles on Earth. I don't think it's a coincidence that it's been another 12,000 years. It's been another almost perfect cycle since the last one. And the magnetic field is changing like it hasn't changed since the last time we had one of these terrible events. I don't see all of those things as coincidences. I see those as providence, as being too blatantly obvious. Kind of like when I'm trying to look at any different little magnetic thing about the Earth, trying to pick apart the notion that you're going to be at the new pole of the planet and another one's going to be at Ecuador and Peru, mm-hmm. and that I'm going to be at the exact same latitude, just in the southern hemisphere. The same way I can't find anything. Everywhere I look, I've just got another piece of evidence. It's the same way from a timeline perspective and from a larger scale physics perspective. Now we're left with one question. Ben, what makes you so sure that it's some kind of nova? Well, I mentioned that it's the only way to explain all of the evidence. Here's the thing. We know there are impactors. And so let's start there. Is it something from the sun or is it an impactor? Do we cross some meteorite field or some long broken up comet path that's got tons of debris in it? Well, the problem is there's nothing about an impactor that's going to reverse Earth's magnetic field or cause the magnetic excursion. They look to those impactors and the heat they create for some of the isotopes, but some of the isotopes that we see can't be explained that way. Iron 60, some of the nickel, aluminum 26, the elements higher than uranium.
Yeah, that aluminum 26 was the one that I keyed in on as far as the energy required to create that isotope is literally astronomical.
The Earth wouldn't be here if it was from the impactor required to do that. We wouldn't be here. The Earth would no longer be. So we know that these came from nova events. And there's two interesting things about it. One, they already knew that it had to be a nearby nova from after the formation of our solar system. Because if it had been from before the creation of our solar system, these short-lived isotopes would be gone. Their half-lives are too short. And for that same reason, we know that these things weren't blown by something, 100 parsecs away or, 300 light years away. They would have decayed on their way here, been obliterated by cosmic rays. So these things had to have been local. But then we had this. Then we had this dusty magnetic pinball paper that solidified a theory that I have been supportive of for a long time. And it's that the dust that carries these isotopes cannot escape the nova shell. The cosmic rays that don't attach to dust, those can go. The light, the X-rays, the gamma rays, the visible waves, the colors, yeah, that gets through. But the actual shock, the dust is not getting through it, which means that when we find these dust-delivered isotopes from relatively recently, from relatively nearby, it's a little more than relatively nearby. It's our star nearby.
Wow.
And these were delivered in these cyclical micronova events that our sun has when it crosses the plane. It's the only way to explain all of that. It's the only way to explain how you can disrupt the crust and have all those other things, because it's going to induce electricity all the way to the core. The cosmic rays, the induced electricity, those things are going to absolutely destroy the thermoelectric equilibrium at the low velocity zone. This would be a good way to explain the sun going black, which doesn't just appear in Christian faiths. The black sun is used in Egypt and all, tons of other places. They swear it's real. It's a real thing. Why would they make this up? These people gave us architecture, geometry, philosophy, and yet the thing they claimed was the most important thing they wanted to convey to us. We're like, yeah, you made that up. That was your fantasy. Are we insane? These are the geniuses we came from. Why don't we listen to them? It's because, well, we got really good at science really quickly and forgot that our time of observing under the period of science is a tiny little nothing in human history, certainly a little nothing in the history of the Earth and the sun. And so we don't have a frame of reference in the time of science for this thing that basically made these geniuses of our past think that gods were angry with them and were on the attack. Think about what it must have taken to make those geniuses of our past think that. It's the kind of thing that is unthinkable to us, but it's real.
Wow. I could go on talking to you about this for weeks. The amount of detail and information there is to digest out there is really astounding. Well, I don't want to wrap up, but I guess I kind of have to. I want you to tell people where they can get more details, more information about all of the things that we've discussed now.
Sure. The YouTube channel is Suspicious Observers. We do a daily update on all things related to this that come out. We do special series on this, and all of our background information, you could literally catch up on years of very, very complex data simplified in a way that you can understand in just a couple of hours at our channel homepage too.
And you have actually about a half dozen websites, is that right?
Yes, but those all stem from the activity in the news. They're described in the news, and it really is good to start at the central modulation point and see what interests you. I mean, maybe someone's interested in learning how to predict earthquakes. There's lots of people we've taught how to do that, and some of them are actually getting some internet credit for some of these things. It's really nice to see. Maybe you really want to know more about the magnetic reversal. Maybe you want deeper dives into some of the things I talk about every single day, or maybe you just want to know more about how the sun interacts with the earth. Maybe you want to know about the community at large and events we're having, other things. All of those have their own websites, but you'll hear about all those if you watch the free daily show. And I certainly recommend that people avail themselves of everything I have that's free, which is more than you can gobble up in a couple days, I promise.
I guarantee it.
Before they even consider doing anything else, please let me overgive as much as humanly possible before you dare think of doing anything else. Well, I'm here for them.
I can attest that, you know, I've followed your work now for about 6 years. It's daily updates, about 5 or 6 minutes every morning, or in my case, in the evening.
But that's right.
A fantastic amount of information in just 5 or 6 minutes. The links that you provide just give you hours and hours of material to go out and digest. There's so much stuff there.
The important thing to note is, because, you know, there's a lot of people that are trying to do these same kinds of things, but my BS detector is about as well honed as anybody's. It says something when the things we were promoting back in 2011 and 2012, to this day, we're still just sharing the links and the studies and other things like that that are confirming these ideas and showing that, hey, science will get there just one baby step at a time. And it's actually a very fun process to watch. Half fun, half frustrating at how long it takes. But
you're going to live until you die, and you have the choice of what to do with your life. And I feel self-education is one of the most valuable things that anybody can do with their life.
Well, you know, there was some education we gave here that could actually save a lot of people's lives where you are. If by chance happen to see that there's some kind of major flash on the sun, and like this is not the kind of thing that you could mistake, be ready within a couple of hours to float away from the place you've called home for the rest of your life, and pray that you don't wind up in the middle of the ocean when it's all said and done.
The problem with the climate debate is that the real issues are so huge that it's almost impossible to conceive of them. When we get into the discussion of burning fossil fuels and releasing CO2, this seems tangible, something we can do immediately that can affect the climate, when in fact we have almost no power at all. When we're talking about scales as big as the solar system or the galaxy, when it takes us at our fastest spacecraft, takes 15 years to reach the outer edges of our solar system, and then we're talking about the galaxy, how can we conceive of these things? And it takes the power away from us. We lose our agency, which is something humans really hate to do. So the thing is, when we start to conceive of the climate changing, we have to remember that there are cycles within cycles within cycles, that the Earth is part of a solar system, that the solar system is part of a galaxy, and that we're traveling through all these different layers of charged particles and current sheets. And on the one hand, it's kind of easy to conceive of, but on the other, it's we can't even grasp the size of the sun, much less that the sun is collecting all this dust and plasma as we travel through the galactic current sheet, and that all that material is collecting on the surface of the sun, and eventually it has to blow off the micronova. And we also can't conceive of the fact that as the Earth's magnetic field is weakening, it's allowing more cosmic rays to enter our planet, and it's softening that sticky layer between the crust and the mantle, and eventually it will get soft enough that the crust will decouple and can actually just float around on top of the molten ball inside. And where I'm standing now could end up under a couple of kilometers of ice not too far from now. Not too long from now. So when we get into the real climate debate, it's important for us to think about the scales that we're actually dealing with. We have to surrender our agency and realize that these forces are far beyond our capacity, not only to understand, but to take control of, and that the best we can do is understand what's happening and prepare as best we can for those eventualities. I'd like to thank Ben Davidson for coming on, and I highly recommend people get over to his channel. It's a fantastic place to start learning about what's really happening, what the real climate change is, and to start thinking about what we can do as a species to survive what's coming. It's happened before, and it will happen again. And all we can do is remediate the damage, hopefully survive what's going to happen, and bring with us as much of our current culture and knowledge as we can, so that once we're on the other side of this thing, we can rebuild faster and get going again. But the first thing we have to do is admit the truth and understand the reality. And people like Ben Davidson are helping us do that. And I highly encourage you to get over and listen to what he has to say. And I hope with that, this past hour has been informative and that you'll come back for more as we explore this very strange world that we live in and get into topics that are more eternal rather than our daily lives, which are very strange indeed anyway, but how much of that is actually based on what's really going on. So just some things to think about, and thanks for coming to Radio Farside. Look forward to having you back again sometime.